Hey Terrainiacs, Mel the Terrain Tutor back in the corner and back with another tutorial for you. And in this one, we're actually looking at something we've done before. Okay, now back when I was a younger Terrain Tutor and the beard was not so grey, we did this video on flocking and clump foliage. And today it's still one of my most popular videos. But as time's gone on, we've shown off a lot of different techniques and to be perfectly honest, I've done a lot of flocking. Yeah, so much so that I'm at a stage now where my style and what I'm doing is completely different to what's in this video. Okay, and so it's time for a knowledge dump. Now, I'll be honest with you, yeah, I've been warned off doing this by a couple of friends and a few other YouTube producers. Yeah, because essentially what I'm doing is I'm giving away my technique, you know, and I am, you know, I do commissions. Yeah, but that's not what I'm about. Okay, I'm about sharing and helping you guys to build better battlefields. So the battle plan is, I'm going to share pretty much everything I know about flocking. And we're going to take the D-Day board, which is the current project. Yeah, from that, okay, to this. Thought you'd like that. Right, in which case, yeah, before we head to the studio and get stuck in and I take you through the various things that you need to do to get that sort of effect, okay, I want to quickly talk about the materials I'll be using, so what I need you to do is just come on over to the bench. Now, when it comes to materials for your flocking, there's loads of companies out there, especially the railway companies. Yeah, the guys like Woodland Scenics, Knock, Scenic Express, and countless others that are producing flock. And they're producing really realistic tones and mixtures. Yeah, I actually prefer a British railway manufacturer. Railway, they don't manufacture railways, but you know what I mean, a scenic manufacturer called Jarvis. Yeah. And that's because they have a premium system and it's a little bit different to everybody else's. Okay, it actually works on strong tones. So what I've got here is with the flock, I've got their mid-tone, which is my base colour, I've got their light tone, and I've got their dark tone, and it's all out of their premier range. And then I've got the mid-tone and the dark tone in a more coarser grass. Yeah, so if I bring this up and I show you, what I mean by tones is, yeah, it is just one tone. There's no mixing, there's no highlights or anything in it. Okay. Now if I sprinkle it down, you can see it there. Yeah, let's give a good sprinkle. Give a good sprinkle, can't we? Always have a good sprinkle. Okay. So moving on, we've got their highlight. Yeah. And then the shade. And then we've got their mid-tone, yeah, which is the mid-green, but in sort of a coarser flock. Yeah, it is bitty, but it's not as fine. It's sort of slightly gripped together, okay? And that gives us a more broken ground covering. Okay, and then that in the shade, so exactly the same. Yeah, but in that dark colour. Okay, now let me go a bit closer for these. Now the reason I like Jarvis Scenic's Premier range so much is because it is solid tones. And when it comes to doing terrain, the challenge isn't getting the nicest materials, but the problem when you're doing it is that instinctually when we look at terrain as humans, we're designed to recognise when things don't look right. Okay, it is just one of those survival things where you look at something and it looks a bit iffy, that's out of place. And we do that with our own terrain. Yeah, and so the key point of making realistic terrain is to replicate nature as much as possible. Now you see, if you used a shade in the wrong place on a piece of terrain, it might look perfectly fine. Okay, but there will be still something subconsciously saying that's not quite right. You may not be able to put your finger on what's not quite right, but there will be something inside you which says it's not quite right. Okay, and so the trick, like I say, to getting that really realistic terrain is understanding what nature does. Where is the shade in nature? Where's the highlight? Yeah, and you can see this if you go out and you look around. Look at any scene and just try and look at any grassy area and look at it in the principle of mid-tone, highlight and shade and see where those areas are. And that's the sort of stuff you've got to pick up. Now, the real good stuff about this is, like I say, it's three tones, so I can replicate my highlight, my mid-tone, my shade. Yeah, also, obviously, in You know, I can do it in Broken Ground as well and keep that matched. Yeah, but the other good thing about the Java Scenics, yeah, is it's not colour set, which means when it's mixed with wet PVA and that sort of stuff, it bleeds out, which is really good because it helps with the blending and blending the colours together. So the aim of this video is I'm going to show you how to create a really realistic scene just using three shades. Okay, and at the end of the day, if you can do it with three shades and get it really realistic, you can do it with anything. You know what I mean? Yeah, so this is like a core principle. If you can get this right, you know, pick up any flock you want, you'll make amazing scenes. So with that in mind, yeah, we've got to head over to the studio and get cracked on, and I'll show you how you can combine this lot to make something rather pretty. Come on then. Okay guys, this is the piece we're going to be flocking up. It's a nice big piece and it'll allow me to show you a load of different techniques across the board. Literally across the board. Okay, now, as I said in the materials, yeah, I'm using Java Scenics because I like the idea that it's a base, it's a highlight and it's a shade. Now, you can use just a normal mix, drop it all over pretty much and it'll look great, yeah? But I like trying to push it and push the level of realism. Yeah, now with that in mind, placement is important, okay? So, although we're going to be giving it a general covering of our standard mid-green, okay? What I am going to be doing is I'm going to be adding highlights, and the areas I'm going to be adding highlights are in are the top exposed areas where it comes close to rock faces, okay, where it comes close to anything particularly dry, yeah, where it comes close to getting dirt and transferring across from being grassy grass to like dirt, okay, basically, yeah, you get lighter colour grass wherever it's more exposed, wherever the ground is more compact, where it's drier, and where it takes most travel, okay? Yeah, so a field with cows on it would have drier grass than, you know, a field with no cows on it, yeah? Not just that, the cows eat the grass, yeah? Now, when it comes to the shade, yeah, obviously the opposite. We're going to be looking at where it's particularly damp, in the shade, out of the way, untravelled, where the earth is softer. So in these cases, we're looking up in the creases at the foot of all the rocks. So whereas we're doing highlight at the rock plateaus, we'll be putting the shade in, yeah, at the lower places. Yeah, down here, and that's how we'll be doing it. Now, yeah, the best thing I can do is sort of bring you in and start to take it down. We're going to be applying the flock with simple PVA. Yeah, I'm going to water down my PVA just a little and I'll show it you when we move on to actually put the flock on. So let's get set up. Okay, we're ready to start flocking. Now, I've thinned my PVA down because if you remember, I used raw PVA. And I've thinned it down just beyond sort of normal consistency of PVA. So basically, it's almost a liquid. Yeah, if I roll it around, you can sort of see. Yeah, and how I'm going to be applying it is with hog hair brushes. Now, I have three brushes here that I use. Yeah, I always use hog's hair brushes for PVA. It just seems to go down there. Yeah, I've got a 2-inch, a large stubby one, and then a fine detail one. 2-inch one I'll use for doing the larger areas, and obviously the smaller ones for the smaller areas. And I'll switch between them as we go. Yeah. Now, one last consideration before we actually start this is a modular piece. So this edge here, yeah, and this long edge here, I can't have any colours transitioning across, okay, because I'll need to match them up on the other side. Now, of course, you could put them next to each other as you do it and blend it that way, yeah, because it's such a large project and I don't really want, I really want to avoid having a lighter patch with a sharp edge and then somehow messing up, not having the light patch on the other one and it just being completely unnatural. So when it comes to the modular edges, they're going to be standard green. Yeah, I'm not going to do any shading or any highlighting on those. Okay, so in for a penny, in for a pound, let's get gluing. Now I'm going to be using a wave effect, and what that means is I'm slowly going to be moving along, applying my PVA, putting my flock down, then reapplying more PVA along and putting my flock down. Yeah, it's simply too big to apply all the PVA in one go and then flock it. Yeah, if you're doing a smaller scatter piece, yeah, you can probably do it in one go. But on something like this, I need to use the wave technique. So, get my PVA, and as you can see, yeah, it's nice and thin. Yeah, and start to put it down. I'm avoiding rocks. Yeah, don't worry about drenching it or anything like that. We can move it around. Yeah, as you can see, it's going down. Yeah, I'm going to use my thinner brushes for catching up on those. I just want to use this big brush for getting the bulk down. Right, first layer bit of glue's down. You can see the runs. Don't worry about those. We'll clean them up afterwards. Yeah, right. Start off. Yeah, we want to do this sort of a little bit exposed. So we're going to put our highlight in and we are simply dribbling little bits. Yeah, I'm not making too much of a clump. No major piles. It's going to be exposed between those, isn't it? I don't want it getting too close to that edge, as I said. Yeah, I'll bring it round here because this would be all exposed. Yeah, and because the PVA is wet, it's carrying through. Okay, next up, shade. Yeah, this is going in where I want my shade. Yeah. You'll notice I've not carried it up here. Yeah, the reason for that is quite simple. Yeah, that's because I want to continue the PVA up there and I don't want to get flock on my actual PVA as I'm going. So we'll put a little bit of shade around there because, I mean, it's a bit rocky, isn't it? Yeah, a little bit of shade around here. Yeah. A bit too much there. We'll blend that out. Right, next up, now we've got our shade in. Yeah, we've got a light bit, we've got our darker spots. We just need to blend it all in, and that means this stuff. Now, when you're doing normal terrain, what you do is you would just get a load of this and you'd just plaster it over a bit like this. Yeah. Now, in this case, because you do that because you can tip it upside down, you can shake all the excess off, collect it on a bit of paper, and then simply move it on, yeah, and reuse it. Yeah, in this case, I can't do that because it's too big to sort of turn up and shake it off, and there'll be too much contamination. So what I've got to do is go in and just sprinkle in enough. Yeah, concentrating on the main areas where it's crossing over. Yeah, I want nice strong lines there. And then I'm just going to carry on sprinkling all this down. Okay, and straight away you can immediately see the effect that that gets. It's so realistic. Now the next job I need to do is basically do the rest of this. Okay, so we're going to be continuing with the wave pattern. I'm going to set the camera up for a long shot so you can see as I go, yeah, and I'll come back when I finish that. Now, one quick note I do have to point out is, obviously we've got a building here and I want to keep a bit of dirt around it. Yeah, in that case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to be very careful about where I place the flock. I'm not so concerned about the PVA, I'll just be more careful about where I place the flock. If you are intending to have sort of a broken effect and you're doing the dump technique, i.e. you're just going to pour it all over, then you've got to be selective about where you put your glue. Okay, so you're either selective about your glue or you're selective about the flock, yeah? But, you know, if you want empty patches, you need to be selective about one. Right, let me set this up for the long shot so you can follow along and let's get this flocked. Thank you. And there you have it, guys. It literally is as simple as that. Simply pick your highlights, pick your shades, go over with your mid-tone, and make sure that you leave about 10% dirt. Yeah, you've seen me sprinkle. The PVA, because it's mixed with water, it's soaked up, it's gripped it. And also, because Java Scenic's flock isn't colour set, and by that I mean when you mix a bit with water, it runs a bit. That helps with the blending because they mix up and create this beautiful, yeah, overall tone. So the next thing we need to do with this is just let it dry, and then we'll move on to adding a bit more coarse clump foliage onto it and taking it to the next step. So here's some photos. Okay, it's all dry now, and what we're looking at is one of the other modular boards. The board we worked on was this one here, and we're going to go back to it in a second. But there's an opportunity for me to just show you a quick couple of things. Now, first off, yeah, remember when I was talking about when doing modular boards, you've got to sort of make sure that you don't have any harsh patches near the edges so the transitions remain strong. And as you can see down here, because we've stuck to our little mid-tones, yeah, to that mid-tone colour, yeah, there's no sort of harsh edges. So when these boards meet, they look perfectly fine. And I don't have to worry about, you know, there being half a brown patch on one side and no brown patch on the other. So always bear that in mind, that, you know, when you're doing your modular boards, yeah, if you've got anywhere that needs to meet up, you need to make it consistent. Now, there are two ways of doing this. You can keep it to the mid-tone, which is the easiest way of doing, you know, one standard tone, that's where all the edges meet. You'll be perfectly fine. The other thing is, you can actually put in the different tones, but what you need to do is make a cardboard template and mark off on the template where your tones are and what tones they are, so you can make sure as you go along to your boards that those tones are in that specific place on each edge. Yeah, so when you line it up, you're never left with like half light on one side and half shade on another side, because that would completely ruin the board. Okay, now the other thing I want to quickly point out is, obviously you can see the sandy bit here, yeah? A little bit of mist there, a bit of a bear patch, we'll fix that, okay? We'll fix that next, I'll show you how, yeah? But as you can see, when I was talking about when we're putting it down and you're getting that feathered, dirty, selective look, I said you can either be selective about where you put your PVA, or you can be selective about where you put your flock. In this case, what I did is, to get this broken up effect of the transition of moving from the beach
over into, you know, what we consider sandy, duney sort of, you know, what it's like walking off a beach. You know, you get to that bit where it's a bit green, but there's sand in between the green, not what's called dirt. Okay, what I did is I stippled very thinly the PVA, yeah, because I only needed a little amount to adhere it down. Okay, and then once again I went in with my selective sprinkling, and what I did is a general sprinkling, then I sort of developed a few hot spots, okay, and these hot spots are where I'm going to develop little grass clumps. Yeah, so basically they're where, you know, the grass has took hold and it's managed to grow a little bit more, and what that'll do is it'll help with the transition even further. Now, when it comes to flocking, yeah, there is a technique called wet working, okay, and we're going to sort of do it next. Now, typically it's done while the flock is still wet, so where we put the PVA down, okay, and we dribbled our flock on, what you would do is you continue adding watered down PVA and building it up while it was all wet. And the reason for this is, while it's wet, the moisture, yeah, will carry the PVA up to the thinner PVA, and it creates a stronger bond, and it allows you to build up layers of detail. Okay, now the reason we didn't do that on this, yeah, is because it's such a large piece, and I'm looking at a 6x4 table, okay, with lots of rocks, lots of detail, you get things like overcasting. So tell you what, let's go down a bit and I'll show you what I mean. Now, because when we put our PVA down, yeah, we were quite brutal with it when we were putting it down, okay, and you've got to be with large boards like this. There is a technique where you can be far more controlled, and I'll show you, we'll talk about that when we do wet working, okay, but as you can see, yeah, you are invariably going to catch and get flock on your details where you don't want them. Now, there's a few different things you can do. Okay, you can re-wet that, which will reactivate the PVA and essentially unstick it. Okay, so a wet damp brush, go in, wet it, leave it a little while, then come back and wipe it off. Okay, I have, let me just get them in the camera here. Yeah, I have a selection of brushes, toothbrushes, plastic barbecue brushes and a wire brush. Yeah, and you can use this to sort of clean them off. Yeah, quite often, the best way to clean them off is just with your finger. Yeah, it's okay on flat surfaces, it's when you get to the rocks and that sort of stuff you start having problems with flat surfaces. Yeah, but as you can see, just cleaning them off. Yeah, brush in. Yeah. Now this is my next job. I've got to go across our entire board and just clean bits up where it's gone a little bit over and it doesn't look quite right. Okay, so that includes on rocks and things like that. And it'll just break off any loose bits and just clean up, because I mean, you wouldn't get grass sitting on top of a rock. Okay. So I'm going to crack on with this. Yeah, and once we've got it cleaned up, we'll move on to sealing and the coarse foliage, guys. Okay, so we've cleaned it all off now and it's looking ready and ready for the next stage. Now, you'll have noticed when we were cleaning it off, yeah, little bits did drop off and fall off. It always happens with terrain. You're going to have little bits which aren't particularly well glued down, and when you brush over them, etc., they fall off. That's perfectly fine. Yeah, it's just an opportunity to put a little bit of clump foliage down. It's perfectly expected. It's easy to deal with, so don't worry about it. If half your flock falls off, you got problems. If you get little spots like this where the odd rock has come off, you know what I mean, it's no big issue. Okay, so moving forward, yeah, what we're going to be looking at doing next is adding a little bit more coarse texture to it before we actually get onto the clump foliage, which, you know, we're covering in a different video. Yeah, so this is the last of the flock. Yeah, and this is this coarse flock I showed you at the start. Okay, it's really good for getting a more realistic broken ground effect. Now, the problem with it is that it's very loose, very light and crumbly, which means it needs to be sort of encapsulated in PVA to grip down. The railway guys who use this, they can get away with sprinkling it on and lightly sealing it, but they're not pushing half a kilo of resin across the table in the form of a tank. Okay, so we need to seal this down quite heavily. Yeah, so with that in mind, yeah, and with this being a demo board and it's going to get a lot of play, I'm going to do a couple of layers of ceiling. Now, when it comes to ceiling, yeah, our core ceiling is good old PVA. Okay, and what I've got here is I've got a ratio. I mean, this is actually one part Baker Ross PVA to nine parts water with a little bit of flow aid to help it flow around. Okay, now when it comes to actually applying it, you can, yeah, just brush it on. But when you brush it on, the thing you've got to consider, okay, is that the moment you put it down, okay, it's going to reactivate the PVA that's holding the flock down. And basically, until it's dried, everything is loose. So if you're going to use a brush to apply it, you need to apply it and move on. And once you've moved on, you do not go back to that area with that brush, yeah, until it's completely dry again and it's all re-gripped, because you will brush away whole swathes of your flock and it will be really frustrating. So it's fine while it's dry, you can tap it down and then move along, okay, if you haven't got a sprayer, anything like that. Now, moving forward, you get really technical and you can get one of these professional woodland scenic sprayers. Yeah, or you can go to the pound shop, buy yourself a little bottle of like window cleaner, pour out the window cleaner, give it a flush out and use that. Nip over to any discount store or go into the makeup aisle and look for atomizers. Yeah, and these are all things that are basically, they create a fine mist. Yeah, and you can give it a good soak. And you can do this at this stage, you can do it at the end. Okay, a lot of terrain builders basically build up all the foliage and once they've got it all done, they give it a good blast. Now, I'm not particularly going to do that. I want a little bit more control. So for this, yeah, and it is, I don't need to show it you guys. It literally is, stand over it, give it a blast. I'm going to be using an airbrush and I'm going to be using a couple of different techniques. This Badger Patriot 105, yeah, it's a cracking little airbrush. Yeah, especially for this sort of stuff. The reason I'm using an airbrush, okay, is when we use watered down PVA, when it gets on rocks and things like that, it can have a tendency to darken them up and kill some of the lighter highlights. So by using an airbrush, yeah, and a very low pressure, I'll be using about 10 PSI to put this through for you airbrush folks. Yeah, it gives me a lot more control, yeah, so I won't go flooding, yeah, where I'm working. Now, that's all very well and good, but there's another technique that I'm going to show you as well. Okay, you can put all the PVA down, yeah, and airbrush it on, or squirt it on, or brush it on as watered down PVA. There's another option as well. What you can do is you can get water with a little bit of flow aid, and you can just spray it over the piece, okay? And then use something like this, which is either a syringe or, you know, a pipette, and then simply come along and add your watered down PVA to it, okay? And because you've got the flow aid in there, that'll grab that watered down PVA and it will carry it across wherever it's wet, which means you're not spraying watered down PVA on your rocks or on your buildings and getting that slightly glossy look, yeah, and losing those upper highlights. Now the thing is, it's quite time consuming. I mean, on small pieces, it's pretty quick to spray them with water, then come in with something like this and just go drip, 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 drip. On something like this, it's just too large. Yeah, which is why I'm using the airbrush. Now, there are certain places where even with the control of the airbrush, I don't want to really give it a go. And more so than this board, on one of the other boards, the little islands that stick up, yeah, I really don't want to get PVA all over those. So what I'll do is I'm going to show you the basic spraying technique with the PVA and then I'll show you the water technique. Now this is sealing, but at the same time, yeah, I'm also going to be flocking it. Yeah, kill two birds with one stone. And to do that, yeah, we'll be getting our coarse foliage, and what I'll be doing is once I've wet it down and I've sealed it, I'll sprinkle this on. Yeah, I'm going to tap it down, then give it a quick spray over, yeah, just to encapsulate it. And then, because it's a thin coat, it'll all be dry for tomorrow for when I move on and do the weathering side of it, yeah, which will be the last bit of the flocking. So, I think the best thing we can do now is get set up and get cracked on, eh? So we're ready to start airbrushing. I've got my airbrush, yeah, I've got my sealant. I've got some just standard water here, yeah, that's if I get too much on the rocks, yeah, I can just
flush it through and just wash it off, yeah, before it becomes an issue. And on top of that, over here, I've got my various sort of, yeah, my coarse foliages that I'll be adding as I go along. On top of that, I've got my mid-tone out of the three tones, just so when I see things like hot spots, yeah, that are a bit too strong, I can just dribble a little on. Now, when it comes to actually doing terrain, what you will see quite a lot of, yeah, is, yeah, people absolutely soaking it. Now, the fact of the matter is, it took a wire brush for me to attempt to scrub, yeah, the flock off the rocks, and I didn't get all of it. So it's already well stuck down, so you don't have to shotgun it. You just need another little sealing coat just to go over the top. So if I look at how thin that is, yeah, it is just barely beyond water. Yeah, like I say, it's a 1-10, a 1-9 ratio. Yeah, but if I come in, I start blowing it. Yeah, top it back up. Yeah, and then crack on. You can see how the air pressure is actually blowing it out. Now this is all you actually need. The moment you start seeing whiteness on it, you're good. Yeah, do you see the whiteness? Yeah, it's just a little highlight, that's all you need. Now I don't have to go absolutely crazy and make sure I get all of it, because I know I'm going along, I'm going to carry on doing this, and I'm going to carry on, what you call it, do more layers as we add more foliage. So all I want to do is just finish off this little bit and go in with the coarse foliage, and then we could just crack on. Yeah, same technique as before. I'm going to layer it, so I'm going to take the moisture so far. Yeah, and then very quickly, yeah, a couple of hot spots I need to touch up. So that one there, that one there, a little bit there, and a little bit there, yeah, and that blends those hot spots out. And then come along and I'll get my coarse foliage, and I'll just start sprinkling it around. Now you are going to lose some of this as it come, as you play and as you work, yeah? The idea is to get the bulk of it gripped down, and then just simply expect to lose some. A bit like with the rocks and that sort of stuff. You will always get bits that don't get stuck on properly. Yeah, and that's okay. It's not a deal breaker, you know what I mean? So, dribble this on. Yeah, and immediately, yeah. Let's break it up a little. Let's get a different bit of a colour. Let's get the other one. Yeah, sprinkle some of that around. Just break this up. And then back in with our watered down PVA. Yeah, going from a far distance, because obviously, yeah, you're going to blow it off as you go. Yeah, so you just need to give it a bit of a saturation. And that's how you do it, and that's how you add the really little clumps. Okay, now, if you are concerned, and you really want to make sure it sticks down while it's wet, just come in, a couple of drops, and that'll make sure that it's all properly stuck down. Yeah, this is that wet working approach. Basically, it's already wet with watered down PVA, so we can come along and very gently just add some extra water in. Right, now this isn't the best position for me to actually do this board, so I'm gonna settle for a long shot so you can watch me work, and we'll get this done, eh? Thank you.
So we've come to the last bit of this board, and it sort of extends out over to where the sea. Now the sea is still curing. You can see these light bits, they'll go as dark as the dark blue. So it's still curing. And I'm reluctant to get PVA on it for obvious reasons. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you the watered down technique first. So I've got my high quality H2O, I've got my airbrush as a simple way of applying it. You could use any sort of squirter, much like with the PVA. And I'm gonna come along, and I can be quite brutal with this because it's only water. So the water's on, next job, a little bit of clump foliage, coarse foliage should I say. Yeah. Drop a bit in there, sprinkle a bit around here, a bit on here. It's quite rough up here, isn't it? Yeah. Now remember, it's only got water on this. You'll see why in a second. Yeah. So I'll get my PVA now. Well, first I tap these down. It's a bit of a stringy bun. And tap these down, let the water grip them. Bits are always coming off. Yeah, and then with our watered down sealant, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to come along. Oh, didn't want to do that. That was the whole point. Overspill, I've got to watch these edges, haven't I? Yeah, get that to see it down. Yeah, and the water is carrying the PVA where I need it. So I'm just putting some gloves down and making sure I've got my clump foliage nice and sorted. I don't want to touch any of this for obvious reasons, because like I say, when it's wet, it will run, it will be loose, and you could quite easily wipe out all your beautiful work. So, I'll put my watch clip, my PVA on, and then the last little bit of thing, yeah, is by adding water, it just lets the PVA spread. Yeah, and that will carry the PVA across to all the bits I need it to carry across to, with no worries whatsoever. Without it running everywhere and ruining everything, that's fine. So there you have it, guys. That's the water down first technique. And as you can see by the picture, you can see where the lightness is, you can see where the PVA is carried, and you can see that it's gripped everything. And you've got a lot more control. Now, obviously, you don't need an airbrush to do this. You can use a squirty bottle because it doesn't matter where the water goes. Yeah, it's about controlling the PVA. And that's the key thing. So this is all basically sealed now. All I need to do now is basically wait for it to all dry so we can finish weathering it. So we'll come back to weathering it in just a sec. Well, it'll be tomorrow now. So all our sealing's dry and it is essentially solid as a rock. Okay, now there's only one last thing I need to show you, and it's a little bit awkward, and I'm in an awkward position because that's how I'm working at the minute, but I only need to generally show you the idea. Now, at the start of the video, yeah, I talked about the idea of using three-tone flocks to get a realistic ground covering. Okay, and as you can see by this, yeah, it works really well. You don't need the fancy flocks. As long as you understand the principles of highlight and shade and the base and the blending, yeah, it all works. But there's going to be areas that you want to muddy up. Now, there's two ways of muddying up areas, okay? And essentially, both are the same ways. You put a wash on them. It just depends on what sort of wash you put on. Incredibly muddy areas, you would put a paint wash, because that will create an opaque wash, and it will change the flock to the mud colour, the colour of the paint. Okay, very much like the grass is soaked in the dirt, and, you know, think of a really, really muddy trail. Now, I don't want to do that. I just want to darken the ground a little. So in that case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go for an acrylic ink wash. Okay, and that will give me a translucent effect. Now, we've covered washes on the channel. Yeah, we've covered doing basic ones. We've covered doing pro ones. And I'll throw links up to those now. But for quick and easy, yeah, I've just grabbed some Agrax Earth Shade. Yeah, I've thrown it into the airbrush. You can apply this with a brush, but you need to thin it down, yeah? An airbrush or a spray is by far the best way of applying this. So, let's get stuck in. Yeah, so if you see these buildings here, now the reason I'm working on two boards instead of just our one demo board is because I really need to make sure that when I shade this, I get it so that the shading meets. And the only way to do that is by putting the boards together. But basically, I've got my Agrax Earth Shade in my airbrush, similar spray settings to the sealant. Yeah, and all I'm going to do is directly angle down and give it a spray. Yeah, I'm not particularly worried about these edges. The only bit I want to make sure is pretty solid and pretty even is there. Now, I'm going to use this technique. I'm just going to use it to darken up this area. I'm going to use it to darken the edge of the craters. I'm going to use it to darken the pass, etc. And it will create a really, really realistic effect. Once again, the trick with all this sort of foliage and stuff is not to go over the top. A little is more. Hints is better than absolutely plastering it. So, simply coming in, yeah, look at that. Look at the difference that makes. Let me grab a photo because you'll be able to see it clearer. Do you see what I mean? Yeah, much better, much, much better. Now I'm going to crack on with this. I'm not going to go for the long shot with this because there's no real need. It's a simple technique. You can see it's just applying it. You can also see why this is quite difficult with a brush to get that effect, because you'll get that large pooling. But I'm going to crack on with this, then I'll give you some photos, and we'll go back to the, whatchacallit, back to the terrain corner for a roundup, guys. So guys, that's it. That's everything I know about flocking. I'm not bad at it, am I? Okay guys, main thing to take away from this is the key to getting really good results isn't using like the expensive, wonderful super flocks. It's about understanding where you're putting your flock and why. Okay, and that comes down to your shading technique, your highlighting technique, making sure your base coat doesn't drown it all out. Yeah, overall in this project, yeah, to do that entire table, I probably used in quantity, yeah, probably about £4 or £5 worth of flock, okay, which is nothing when you think about it. Obviously, if you were going to do it, you need one bag of each, so you're probably looking at about a tenners. Yeah, but you'd have stuff left over. Yeah, so it's not expensive yet. You've also seen how I've used the PVA. You don't need special adhesives. You can use spray adhesives and stuff like that. You can use matte varnish, but PVA works really well. And especially with the Jarvis Scenics and that blending, works really, really well. Just remember when you're mixing in with your PVA, it is white, so it is going to highlight and make it more vibrant. So think what it looks like if it's once it's shaded down. You know what I mean? Yeah, same with the actual weathering and the shading techniques. Yeah, with the washes. Yeah, you can use commercial washes. I use probably about that much of a tub, you know, a tiny amount. Or you can make your own acrylic ink washes if you're planning on doing a lot of weathering. Yeah, if you want a really muddy one, make your washes out of a paint pigment instead, and that'll give you your opaque look. And that's about it, guys. You know, we covered, you know, glue down, we covered distribution, and we've covered a lot, haven't we?
Wow, I never knew I knew so much about flocking. Right, guys, obviously, I'm always after learning, so if you've got anything to add to this video, throw it in the comments. If you've got any questions, you need, if you didn't understand something, you know, I'm always in the comments. It may take me a day or two to get there, but I'll get there and I'll get you an answer. Okay, guys, so, and then finally, listen, if you appreciate the fact that I'm putting it all out there, you know, because commercially, I'm sort of stabbing myself in the backside here, you know what I mean? Yeah, listen, I really would appreciate your support, yeah? It just helps me do more terrain and less night shifts in the warehouse, you know what I mean? So, if you really like it, check out Patreon. Consider the $1 pledge. $1. Yeah, that's not even a coffee a month. You know what I mean? Anyway, yeah, I'm not going to rattle on about that because, to be perfectly honest, yeah, I'm really chuffed with the results and it's been a good one. So, guys, if I don't see you before, look after yourselves and I'll see you live Sunday night, 9 o'clock UK time for the live show. See you later, Terrainiacs. Ta-da.